Maritime Resource Assessment together with the Bureau of Fisheries, DA Bureau of Fisheries Aquatic Resources, and the Bureau of Fisheries National Research and Development Institute, NFRDI. And we went to the two Ks, K1 and K number 2. I joined the K number 2 expedition group. But this morning and yesterday, we kind of consolidated all our observations. So the things that I'm going to present today was based on our leveling off of what we observed as our initial impressions, in particular for two things. One is the status of the reef biodiversity or marine resources underwater. And also the second one is regarding the sort of the pile of rubble, coral rubble, that we can obviously see in K2. So I'll deal first with the underwater status of the marine resources. For both K1 and K2, what we both noticed, all the teams, that the corals in this area are typically small and boulder type. So they kind of like a shape of your head, but mostly small. And there are also this kind of boulder shaped coral, we call massive corals, that are big, but now most of them are dead, covered in algae. So based on this observation, we kind of conclude that the coral reef ecosystem, contrary to what we expected, which yesterday I told you that I'm expecting that there should be large corals, lots of diversity, different species, because these are offshore reefs, turned out to be actually untrue. What we found is actually low diversity, very few species. Many of them are shape of our head or massive type. Very few are branching. There are very few branching species, and which later on I'll try to connect to the pile of rubble that we can find on the sandy bar that's piling up. Okay, that's obvious. The second one, in fish, so quite a wide area at a depth of around 6 to 9 meters, 10 meters. And the feature of these reefs is usually very flat underwater. It's not a steep slope, but rather a very gentle slope. So you can, the water is very clear, so you can see what's in there. So overall, what we found is that for both fish and corals, there seems to be a suggestion that these reefs are not healthy anymore, because the dead corals and the few big fish, in fact, the lack of big fish. So in many of the reefs that I survey around the Philippines, because I do national surveys, when you see reefs that are lacking big fish, typically this indicates overfishing. Because a protected area with few fishing activities or fishing effort usually would at least have, let's say if the corals are degraded, will at least have big herbivores or fish that are relying on algae, but the predators will be gone, right? So the fact that these reefs have corals, although small and still alive, and have a lot of algae, but there are no big fish, not even the herbivore type or those fish that would eat algae, suggests that this fish could be undergoing either habitat stress, or there could be some form of human activities like fishing that overexploit the fish. But for sure, we don't know if this is overfishing. It's just that what we observe, because we don't have long-term monitoring, is that there's now a lack of big fish in this area, which is in typical reefs in the Philippines indicative of overfishing activities. Okay. Now, the second point is in relation to the question about the rubble, the pile of rubble that are obvious, which is quite large, and for those of you who went there, is almost perfectly circular. Right? It's not following the contour of the reef, because if you look at the reef from satellite, it's not circular, right? So there are things that I noticed that in my head and based on my discussion with the rest of the teams are kind of unusual in this area. So after we dove at the deep part of the reef, I also swam the shallow reef around the area K2. So around it, I saw the reefs on the shallow water. On the exposed side, underwater, you'll see a lot of rubble, dead coral, rubble, branching, but these are fine branches. On the unexposed or the sheltered, those that are away from the big waves and the wind, you'll actually find big live colony of corals that are shaped like roses. We call this foliose shape, a foliose It's like leaf, but in the form of a rose. And big ones, some colony are like this, like over almost half a meter to more than half a meter. And some branching corals, mostly of varieties. Many of these live corals, we cannot find in the pile of rubble. So that's one thing. The second thing is that many of those corals that we find in the deep, those massive type that are small, like the head, the boulder, we cannot also find this in the rubble, right? The pile of rubbles, it's not there. And the third is that the rubble that we found on the mounds are much larger than those what we find underwater. Many of them are larger than the branching corals. So again, indicating that it's kind of different from what's underwater. So that's the third. The fourth point is that if you look at the gradients of the distribution of the rubble from the deep to the piles, there's a very clear cut difference. The pile are very white, even those that are immediately submerged on the water are very white. Whereas if you go a little bit away from that, this is a very flat distribution of rubble that are covered in algae. Whereas the pile don't even have pieces of coral that has algae on it. So again, another strange thing that if you look around here in Pag-asa, you walk around, there are rubble that are from the deep, but they're covered in algae, and they're also distributed on those that are exposed. But those exposed rubble with algae are not found in those mounds. All that we saw are very white corals or very gray corals. So again, these are strange. That's the fourth observation. The fifth observation is that those live corals that we saw that are foliaceous or kind of rose type underwater are suddenly now covered in a massive pile of rubble. Almost half of it is now covered. This is not common. If there's a wave that brings this rubble from, let's say, from the exposed area, it will be probably a gentle, not a sudden cut, like the whole colony is cut into half. One with a really tall cover of rubble, the other half is clean. Sharp, there's a sharp edge, as if it's been put there. It kind of looked like that, okay? So these are pieces of evidence, so that's the fifth. Now, if you walk on top of this rubble, and you take, I'm sure you took photos of this rubble, there are sections, almost like rectangular, wherein you can see a clear line, where on this line, one side is white, the other side are very dark gray, as if some events. I don't think nature will put something like this clear-cut line. The waves will create this kind of very sharp lines. So again, these are mysteries to us. Because this is our first observation, and we don't know how those things actually occur, how those things happen, my suspicion is that it cannot be my conclusion from all my observation is that it's very unlikely that those mounds of rubble are the same from those that we found underwater. So what we did actually is we took a lot of samples of, so that because the samples on top, the rubble are actually very degraded. You can see, we can no longer see the what we call the coralites or those character of the corals that will be useful for us for identifying the corals themselves. So we took the samples, but we need to analyze them to find out if those indeed in the rubble are the same with those that we found underwater. But based on initial impression, many of these piles of rubble are not the same with those that are in the, there are many of those that are underwater that are not there. So this is, but again, we need a lot of further observation. We probably need monitoring if this mound will grow unusually. And we probably need to dig some of this piles, if we see like underwater, if there's some kind of really piling up, that's distinct. But the thing is that all those pieces, six items of observations, seems to indicate in my head that this is unnatural. Now, I observe what happened to Yolanda. So when Yolanda happened, 2 days before Yolanda, I was doing my national reef survey, and the first flight of the first flight of PAL, I actually took that flight to get back to the area, just bringing my snorkel, my fins, and not even bottle of water, just one shirt and a jacket. I went there, and so what I actually saw is that it's true that Yolanda formed some reefs, But the corals that were formed are similar to those that you see underwater, and there are algae that are covering even those on top. This is lacking. And the height of these formations are not more than the height of a person. I've never seen, Yolanda is the strongest typhoon ever to land the Philippines. If that happened here, there's a strong typhoon, either the current or the wave so strong, it can pile up that rubble, which is beyond the height of a person. You can see, like yesterday, if you stand up on the water level, that rubble is more than our height. So I didn't see that, Yolanda. And again, the lack of the algae, the cover, the lack of continuity with the underwater rubble. All of these pieces and in connection to the Yolanda, especially those reefs that are shallow like that reef in Yolanda area will also form that kind of island of rubble, but it's still different from what I observe in Yolanda. So again, all I'm saying is that I find a lot of these pieces of structures and features that for me is unusual, and in my head maybe it doesn't really come from there. But then we need more research to really verify if all this sort of initial impression are really true, because we don't know if it was put there. We don't know who put it there. We haven't had any observations, and if it's the current, it doesn't seem to be like the action, like, because the perfect shape, it doesn't follow the contour, and then all the edges are sharp all around, whereas the other area is unexposed, right? If the other area is unexposed, that will probably have the sharp edge, whereas the other area, if it's exposed, it will probably have a gradient from the continuous wave exposure. But it all around it are all sharps, mostly sharps, except maybe some are now collapsing from maybe some reef. But again, I think this kind of science, like any other science, there are uncertainty to the statements I made, and I cannot definitely say that this is man-made or somebody formed it, because I don't really know. But there are features that, like the scouring, like in the middle of this mound, it's not like a mound that will be steep gradually, but rather there are areas where there's like a sudden concave sections that doesn't look like an action of a wave or a wind. So again, many of these things are a mystery to my head, but I don't have any other evidence to support what form, what shape this rubble. So these are just the features that are curious and unusual for a reef that is formed by a wind or a current or a storm.
Third question, Alison from Fuji TV. Just taking your technical terms and your knowledge about marine diversity, may I ask, because during our interview, may I ask first, are K1 and K2 spawn area for fish?
I think any reef in the Philippines that have reef fish will be a potential spawning ground, because all these fish will spawn, right?
Yes. Yeah. So we interviewed a fisherman, and he got a fresh catch of small fish similar to the size of tuyo, but they are lapu-lapu. And I remember when we saw that guy. And then according to him, that's the kind of fish that they are getting now from the area. So would you relate this to what is happening on these
Yeah, so when I first came here 2 days ago, I went around and swam underwater around here. And same with what you said, what we can find here are small fish, mostly what we call surgeon fish, and some of the lapu-lapu, which is called grouper. So I think those are the most common fish families that are found here, but many of them are less than a foot in size, and many of them are only around 30 or 20 cm. And the surgeon fish you can find maybe about 30 cm or about 40, but most are under 30 cm.
So this definitely affects the lives of our fishermen here in the area.
This means that if they simply swim and fish nearby, most likely they will catch small fish. They probably have, like many Filipino fishers now, they have to go offshore a little bit deeper to find big fish. So, which is, I thought that since here, if you look around, there are only about 20 boats, that I would have expected that the fishing pressure here is much lesser than any common island. Like if you go to Bohol, an island this size will probably have about 2,000 fishers, 100 or 500. Many of these small islands have thousands of fishers. So therefore, that would explain the overfishing. But here, since there are only 20 boats, you would have expected that less pressure, and there's no commercial, there's no market. Basically, these are all for their own consumption. But based on my other studies of the Philippine reefs as well in across the country, coral reefs are not really able to support a huge fisheries to some extent, because especially if the habitat is like this habitat here now, are somewhat degraded. Many of the small fish don't have a place to hide, and they don't have an area where they can probably shelter themselves from predator. So if there are no small fish, there are no food for the big fish. So therefore, that's why you probably don't find big fish. So again, these are all interconnected.
So the very important diversity in case one and two, with very limited numbers of fishing vessels, what can you assume, or at least...
So this is another thing that we're very uncertain, because we don't have long-term monitoring of these areas. That's why for me, the most important thing I think that the Filipinos should really develop is to do a regular monitoring of these important reefs, which are, I think, critical to all the reefs around either Southeast Asia or in the Philippines. Because these are, if you look at the map, these are the reefs in the middle that probably will become like a stepping stone for many of the biodiversity that would either go to Vietnam or go to Indonesia. So if we lose the diversity here, that could have an effect on the distribution of this fish either back to Palawan or going to the Indonesia and other nearby reefs surrounding the West Philippine Sea. So meaning that, to answer your question, this is very important that we monitor and understand, because right now we don't know if this decline is really due to too much fishing, because we don't have record. But it could be also related to the habitat change, because as I said earlier, there are many of the big corals before that I'm sure are alive, now are dead. So this could be a switch in habitat, could have affected as well the reef fish.
Sir, you mentioned about the rubbles, and you don't know if this rubbles or the expansion in the area is caused by natural phenomena or an outside force or source. What should we do, or at least what do you think about it?
So there are many other things that we can do to verify some of the hypotheses we have. Like we can, for example, dig some of this rubble and see what's underneath it. We can further analyze the samples, like really take more samples of rubble from underwater and compare that to the samples of rubble on top of this pile. And the other thing is really to monitor this rubble, because if it will grow naturally, if it will suddenly increase without any storm or without any strong waves, then that's... But also, if we can really find, if somebody puts it out there, hopefully we can find out. But that's the thing that we need to know. We need to monitor this rubble. We need to consistently monitor and continuously monitor this rubble, how it will change, so that we can add more layers to what we know now, and we can find some answers to those part of the story that we know are uncertain as of today.
Yeah.
Okay.
Despite these fears, what are your recommendations?
For me, for the marine resources, I really highly recommend to all Filipinos, all agencies, all researchers, NGOs in the Philippines, that it's a good idea to create these islands here in Kalayaan. And Philippines should lead in either the management, monitoring, and recovery in cases where the reef fish have declined, or in cases where the corals have died off. And we can only do that if we have a regular monitoring system, but also if we have an intention that we lead in the management of this system. I think that the future of these islands will have a significant effect on all the fisheries in Palawan and across the Philippines, because these reefs here will have connectivity to other places in the West Philippine Sea, up to north, or even in the Visayan Sea. We don't know for sure, because we don't have extensive studies of the connectivity of where larvae come from for those species that we see here, or where do they go once they are here. So we need this kind of study. But for me, I think it will be a most positive story for the Philippines if in the next foreseeable years, or immediately from here onwards, there will be a consistent monitoring, but there will be an actions to manage these resources to recover it. Imagine 2 years or 3 years from now, we'll be having this discussion again. And that time, because of the management, we now find big fish. the corals are coming back. This is a good story for the rest of the for the world, for the global community, not just for the Philippines, but in particular for the Filipinos, because the Filipinos, majority of the Filipinos, are highly dependent on reef fisheries for their livelihood, for their food. So I think this is a very important recommendation. But this can be done if we have consistent monitoring and also an intent to manage and recover these resources.
Yeah. So, given the presence of Chinese ships, so we can see it's very visible, sir. What activities have you monitored that could have led to the overfishing or the destruction or unhealthy coral ecosystem that our scientists have?
Serpent.
Well, I would love to hear it from science, no, in explaining the impact of the deployment of Chinese maritime militia. As you are all aware, around Pagasa Island, we can actually see from here more than 15 Chinese maritime militia. And also, when you went to the case, there were already Chinese maritime militia also swarming the area. Again, I don't have the science to explain the impact of their presence, but it is worth mentioning that when the swarming of Chinese maritime militia happened in Iroquois Reef and also in Luzon Reef and Sabina Shoal, in which we asked the support of the UP Marine Science Institute last November, we saw that there were a tremendous impact on the coral reef underneath those Chinese maritime militia that stay there for a long time. But as to the specific impact, as far as my limited knowledge of understanding marine science of it, is that these vessels try to imagine how can they be able to manage their waste, for example, if they're going to stay at a long period with so much number of vessels in a particular area. So perhaps that might be one of the other reasons why we have a very poor biodiversity in these areas. That despite of the fishing activities from the locals here in Pagasa, we still have very poor condition of the coral reefs.
Have you monitored any fishing activity from their end near Pagasa?
Well, to be honest, the entire Pagasa Island, of course, is we have this coordination with the Philippine Navy, the Armed Forces of Philippines, and even the Philippine National Police, Maritime Group, and the Coast Guard. As far as we are concerned, there are no foreign fishermen that fish within the territorial sea of Pagasa Island. I think it was last year wherein a foreign national was monitored for the Philippine Navy that is engaged in fishing, and then the Philippine Coast Guard and the Philippine Navy together with the PNP Maritime Group apprehended this foreign national who was engaging within our territorial waters.
And then last from you, sir, you know, K2, that's very interesting that it was mentioned that were mounds or piles of rubble. So have you monitored any human activity in that area that could have caused that?
I would like to emphasize and anchor on the narrative of Dr. Antica Maria that obviously, you know, the expansion of K2 is quite surprising based on their initial assessment. But let's say that it's not really caused by a natural phenomenon, but the same thing with what he said. For this time, the national government, the National Task Force West Philippine Sea, hasn't have any data yet to attribute to any person or any state actor that there was really an activity that would facilitate the expansion of K2.
Sir, having heard the initial findings, what is the Coast Guard's next moves on these days? Would you go into monitoring or?
Well, I would like to mention that the effort of the Philippine Coast Guard and the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources is not just decided by these two government agencies. Of course, our action is always sanctioned by the National Task Force West Philippine Sea. And based on the scientific investigation, formulating policy recommendations coming from the result of this marine scientific assessment, I love to believe that the National Task Force West Philippine Sea would be willing to consider the policy recommendations that will be given by our friends from the academic, because our approach in the West Philippine Sea is more of a whole of nation approach. It includes not just the Armed Forces of the Philippines, the Philippine Coast Guard, or even the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources. We also take recommendations from the academic, particularly those who are really authority when it comes to science.
Sir, news agencies from China are reporting that it appears that the China Coast Guard spokesperson have said that the mission yesterday was thwarted and even evicted. They're using those words. Would you like to set the record straight or clarify? Obviously, we were able to continue
that mission. Yeah. Well, even without my statement, I know for a fact that the media friends were embedded to the BFAR vessels could be able to attest that the statement of the Chinese Coast Guard that they were able to prevent us from completing our marine scientific research is not really factual. That's another lie coming from the Chinese Coast Guard because, as I said during my initial briefing, we departed Pagasa Island at 1000. We were able to complete the marine scientific research after 1400. That means that for 4 hours, we were able to continue our research with our marine scientists. And despite of their provocative actions by the Chinese Coast Guard vessels deployed there, doing dangerous maneuver and blocking operation, and the Chinese maritime militia's illegal presence in Pag-asa case, we were able to complete our marine scientific research. So again, these are just a false narrative coming from the Chinese Coast Guard, and I don't have to ask the media to speak on behalf of the government because you know what really transpired yesterday.
Sir, Jeff from Benner News, can we initially say that the deteriorating condition of our biodiversity here in Pagasa is caused by Chinese militia because these people are hanging out there, staying there for months, even for years, they will just have rotation. And then when we arrive here, we notice that every night they're using this huge light. They call it light fishing, so they will attract all the fish. If they are doing that for years or maybe that's a result of just for the poorer conditions. Okay? And comments?
Well, I don't want to speculate. Again, according to Dr. Ente Camara, there are a lot of reasons to. There are probably a lot of human interventions that we would consider in looking into why there is a poor biodiversity of coral reef in Pagasa Island. I would like to wait for the final result of the investigation conducted by Dr. Ente Camara before the national government or the National Task Force West Philippine Sea will issue a statement. But of course, yes.
In order for us to definitely answer such kind of question on the impact of, let's say, the super lights that we see and the fishing, if there's fishing, I think we have to establish if those are indeed fishing. So we need to monitor those activities and also analyze really what are the impacts. So really monitor the consequence of those activities if those are fishing.
But for now, we don't have any of those monitoring system in place. So again, we probably won't be able to answer that, and all our statement will be speculative until such time that we do monitor. But as we can see, all of us at night, there are super lights, very bright lights, and there are already publications put out there that these super lights are attracting fish. But we need to do this kind research to be able to answer these kind of questions.
You've mentioned earlier that one of the Chinese vessels blared their sirens for 20 minutes to attract the attention of Chinese militia around the area. The question is it legal for them to use their sirens for around 20 minutes using a BFAR, vessel?
Well, to begin with, the presence of the Chinese Coast Guard within Pagasa case is actually illegal. Because again, the Pag-asa Island generates a territorial sea of 12 nautical miles. This means we have sovereignty over these waters, and their mere presence in disrupting our marine scientific research, in which we are locally conducting, is a violation of UNCLOS, and they failed to recognize and blatantly violate our territorial integrity over these waters. So with or without the siren, the mere fact that they are illegally present within this water is a violation of our territorial sovereignty.
Okay. So likewise, what is the, what is the implication of the PNA Navy helicopter, the tail number 57, circling around the area while they were conducting their surveys?
Well, the PNA Navy helicopter has been persistently present in all our operations in the West Philippine Sea. We were able to monitor them in Bajo de Masinloc. We also monitored them in Sabina Shoal while we were waiting for the entire supply contingent last 2 weeks ago. We still see them every once in a while. We have, whenever we conduct marine scientific research in different areas. So I think the main objective of the PLA Navy vessel, besides from surveillance of our activities, is that also to show off that they can see our activities that we are conducting.
Yeah, so again, the question is that will this degradation or lower biodiversity here in Pag-asa that we observe have impact on nearby reefs around the region? And the answer is that most likely it will have an impact because reefs are generally interconnected, and many of the reef fish and corals have what we call larval dispersal system, wherein the babies are actually transported to other reefs. So if you have, therefore, a reef that used to be alive and productive, and they can produce all these babies to be transported to other nearby reefs, now this will stop. So again, this will have an impact to all the rest of the other nearby reefs that are relying on those supply of larvae from these reefs in Pag-asa and the Sandy Cays and the Calayan Island groups in general, if these reefs are now suffering degradation or now have many, many small coral colonies. And typically, small coral colonies means our reproductive output is small or very, very, very low. And the same with very, very small fish. It means that the reproductive output of these supposedly large fish that are now small will be very low. So this will have an impact to the fisheries, the biodiversity, and the food production across the region, not just in the West Philippine Sea, but probably in the ASEAN or nearby reefs that are similar to these reefs and are relying on these reefs, yeah.
So we
very likely, yeah.
So we need more research to determine how big the impact.
We need an ideal scenario would be that all the reefs around this, the West Philippine Sea, like Indonesia, Vietnam, and other members of the ASEAN will conduct a joint research to really see the interconnections of all these reefs and see how they are interconnected, so that if we destroy some portions of these reefs, it will have a grave consequence on these are really ideal scenarios. It would be great, I think, for the ASEAN to conduct such kind of joint research for the benefit of all, not just the global community, but for the regional community in particular that are dependent on these reefs.
Sorry, very there.
Sir, yung visual observation, how about yung iba pang part ng research? Kailan ba na
wala? Ah, okay, so...
Samples of research.
Ah, yeah, so yesterday we took some samples of those rubble and we need to process them, and I don't know because we need to access some lab for the processing, and but for the final report of this, I asked them if they can give me about a week to 12 days for the final report, and then I can discuss that with them and the rest of those agencies that sort of tasked me to conduct this with the BFAR, and then so the BFAR, we will conduct the joint report. The BFAR, DA BFAR, the NFRDI, all the members of the team will be signatory to that report. So we're expecting about maximum of 12 days from now, but there's Holy Week. So I'm not so sure how willing the people to sacrifice the Holy Week, but that's my commitment. And then, but the samples, it has to be dependent on the laboratory work, because we need to process those, because these are really degraded rubble. These are not fresh rubble. Many of them, you can see the surfaces are now destroyed, so it would take us a bit of time.
And of course, in line with the transparency strategy of the National Task Force Stress Ball Agency, the moment that we have already received the final report of those collaborative agencies who lead the marine scientific research and assessment, we're going to have another press conference. We're going to present once again Dr. Antikamara to you to explain to you the details and the result of the scientific research that they have already completed.
So you have to also realize that we still have to complete the research. So we still need to add to the analysis.
Okay,
so. And I really hope that this is just the beginning, because right now we have these are interesting questions and these are very important questions, but we haven't done extensive work in this, and so that's why I said there's a lot of uncertainty. But if we do more research, many of these uncertainties will disappear. So I hope that we can continue the research in this region, in this area, and with the help of not just the BFAR, DA, and other, but many other interested parties that whose lives are dependent on the West Philippine Sea. And the global communities, I think, are also looking into this, because this is the only region that has coral reefs in the entire planet, that has the richest biodiversity in the entire planet. So, meaning that these coral reefs are not just important to ASEAN, but the rest of the world, because in the entire planet, this is where we find it. Not in Canada, not in Germany, but only here. So I think to them also that matters, because this is a special part of the planet. So. All right.
Thank you.